Hi guys, as you might remember from the previous episode, we said that due to accommodation, doing the same thing over and over again will eventually stop working, which implies that in order for us to keep making progress, we will have to manipulate some of the training parameters. But there are a few more reasons for why we have to vary our training. Number one is to fully develop muscle belly. For example, most of you probably know that doing bench press will mostly hit your lower and outer pec. And in order for you to have a complete pec development, you will have to include at least some incline work. But since the resources of a drug-free athlete are limited, you might not be able to have both of those exercises in your program at the same time. The second reason is to prevent overuse injuries. For example, I find French presses to be very effective for my triceps. But if I do them for very long, my elbows start to get sore. And that's why I have to periodically alternate them with other triceps exercises to make sure I don't ruin my joints. The last one here is to prevent boredom. And I have to be careful about this one because some people will get bored during their first training session ever. This is not what this is about. What we're talking about here is doing the same thing over a period of months or even years. And of course, the Bulgarian weightlifting system is the best example of this. No matter how motivated and dedicated you are, if all you ever do when you come to the gym is try to max out and single in a handful of exercises, such extreme monotony of training can start taking away from how enthusiastic you are about doing any of this. To ensure none of this happens, there are two main ways for us to vary our training. Number one is by changing sets and reps. And that's pretty straightforward. So for example, for a few weeks you do 5 sets of 5 reps in all your exercises, and for the following few weeks you do 3 sets of 8 to 12 reps. The second one is by changing exercises. And that doesn't even have to mean that you have to do different exercises. You can just modify exercises that you're already doing by changing a stance or how wide your grip is. And while you're implementing all these variations, you still have to make sure that you're choosing from the most effective training tools you have available to you. And the second thing to keep in mind, that you still have to be able to objectively see how you're progressing. So for example, if today I'm doing a bench press, a week later I'm doing incline press, and a week after I'm doing decline press, it is very difficult for me to see if I'm actually getting stronger or I'm just doing something different. Some of you might be familiar with old bodybuilding philosophy called muscle confusion. And although that is definitely along the lines of what we are discussing here, if your primary goal at the gym is to do something different every time, it is very difficult for you to be compliant with specificity of training and progressive overload. And perhaps a better way to go about it is by having variation pre-scheduled into your training. And that's what periodization is all about. There are many different definitions of periodization, and there is also some disagreement in terminology, and a lot of it has to do with overlap between periodization and loading patterns. And this is something that Dr. Bompa talks about in his periodization book. But we're not going to worry too much about semantics here, and instead we're just going to have a quick review of some of the most common periodization styles. Linear periodization implies that as you move from week to week, the volume of your training decreases and the weights that you are using increase. And this is something that is probably more appropriate for beginner, intermediate level powerlifter or for a bodybuilder that wants to focus on strength for a while. Just don't expect these numbers to play out as nicely as it's written here, because as I said in one of my previous videos, the number of repetition that you can perform with a particular percentage from your one repetition maximum will vary. The second thing to keep in mind is that you don't want to have these phases too stretched out, because when you're on a higher volume end of things, you're probably not using weights that are heavy enough for you to maintain your maximum strength. And then if you stay on the lower volume end of things for too long, you might actually start losing some of your muscle size. But otherwise, this is a pretty straightforward way to plan your training. Reverse linear periodization is pretty much the opposite of what we just discussed. So here, as you move forward, the volume of your training sessions will increase and the weights that you are using will decrease. So this is something that is probably more appropriate for hypertrophy work, or if we took it even further, for muscle endurance work. The only thing about reverse linear periodization is that it's hard to know exactly by how much to decrease the weight. Because as you might know, as you get bigger and stronger, you're technically supposed to lift the same weight for a higher number of sets and reps. So this is something that you're going to have to play with and figure out for yourself. But otherwise, reverse linear periodization is another good way to schedule your training. Concurrent periodization is a training style where multiple motor abilities are addressed within the same training session. So to illustrate, we have an example of a chest training session here. And as you can see, the first exercise is for strength, the second exercise is for muscle hypertrophy, and the third exercise is for muscle endurance. And the order is important here because you wouldn't want to start your training session with muscle endurance work and then move on to strength training when you're already fatigued. Also, the number of athletic qualities that is addressed within the same session could be much wider. So you could start with some speed work and finish with some general endurance, like sprints, for example. And this is something that CrossFit does. The only thing to keep in mind is that at the very advanced level, the amount of stimulus that is required to further improve any of these qualities could be so great that you might not be able to sufficiently address all of it within the same training session. But since most of us are not very advanced athletes, this is another good way to plan your training. Essentials of strength training and conditioning states that undulating periodization involves large daily fluctuations of load and volume within a week or a microcycle. And to illustrate what that means, we have an example of back training here. And as you can see, Monday is geared more towards strength training, while Friday is all about hypertrophy. And there are many different ways to do it, but the point is that we address different athletic qualities on separate training sessions. And as you might remember from our progressive overload episode, we said that such approach would be more appropriate for intermediate and advanced athletes. When people say periodization, what they usually mean is block periodization. And what that is that training process is broken into distinct phases of training, with each phase having its own flavor. So for example, if you're a bodybuilder and want to vary your training, you can focus on the lower end of a hypertrophy rep range for months and then move up to a higher end for the following month. And then just keep alternating like that over and over. And there are many different other ways how these blocks can be varied. But the bottom line is that block periodization is a very effective training tool for athletes at any level. Just like everything else about super training, its definition of conjugate periodization is very complicated. But what it basically says is that conjugate periodization is a block-style periodization in which each successive block benefits from performance improvements gained in the previous block. And this is something that is also referred to as phase potentiation. And let me illustrate what that means. Let's say I want to become a very powerful puncher. It would be logical for me to first get as big as possible, then make these new big muscles as strong as possible, after which I would combine the strength with speed and become as powerful as possible. As you can see, each successive block benefits from the previous one. But now let's look at a different example. Let's say I was doing bodybuilding for a while, then I switched to long distance running, after which I decided to focus on powerlifting. As you can imagine, the powerlifting here wouldn't benefit so much from all the previous running, and all this running wouldn't benefit so much from the previous hypertrophy work. And perhaps a better way to schedule this would be to move this out here as a GPP phase. And that's really what phase potentiation is all about. It's about scheduling various blocks of training in an optimum way. I also have to mention that Louie Simmons gives slightly different description of conjugate periodization. But at the end of the day, the logic is the same. It's all about sequencing various training methods to get the most outcome at the end. And to wrap things up, I just want to say that it's not so much about which periodization style is best, and it's more about which one is more appropriate for your goal. And it's best to look at periodization as a map that will lead you to whatever the destination you're trying to arrive at with your training. And that's going to be it for this episode, guys, and I'll see you next time.